Finally, the next generation, you could say, of mini PCs is here, thanks to AMD with their new 6000 mobile series. So this model is the MOREFINE or the MOREFINE M600. It is powered by the Ryzen 9 6900HX, and it's one of many mini PCs I'll be reviewing and covering with this new chipset. So what it does have is some big changes. We've got DDR5 support now, a higher turbo on the integrated graphics, which is 2.4 gigahertz, and it is the 680M. It's got PCIe 4.4 support, can take two SSDs with PCIe 4.0, or even a SATA 2.5-inch drive can fit within this. Wi-Fi 6E, DDR5 RAM, so my model here's got 32 gigabytes, and 512 gigabytes of storage. So we'll see what this M600 is all about and the performance improvements we can expect from the new 6900HX compared to the 5900HX, the last gen model. Included in the box, you'll find a power supply. Now this is almost 120 watts for that powerful Ryzen 9 to 6900HX. Power supply cable, we have a bracket here, so yes, it can be VESA mounted, placed on the back of a monitor, for example. We've got a SATA cable, so that's a SATA cable there. You can add a 2.5 inch drive, this is good to see. There is a stand included, HDMI cable, some screws, and two mounting screws there for the VESA mount. And you'll find a little bit of paperwork here, so just some basic quick start guide here that goes over the ports and everything. As I mentioned in the intro there, that we've got now, of course, the next generation of the Ryzen chips here, the mobile chips, and this is one of the most powerful ones. So we get the big boost in mostly the integrated graphics. So we've got that 680M now, which is almost up to double the performance of what we had before with, say, the Vega graphics. Clocked now at 2.4 gigahertz, DDR5 support, PCIe 4.0 support with the SSDs, and we've got here two gigabit LAN ports, 2.5 gigabit ports. So that's great to see there. HDMI 2.1 out. So yes, you can run 4K 120 hertz. I've done that with my LG CX monitor and my Philips LG one, and it's working just fine. DisplayPort 1.4, and there's also a Type-C port on the front that can output display 2 up to 8K 30. So we've got the three display out options. So USB 1.3 here, and then three USB 2 specs. So a little bit slow, but that'll be good for just plugging in things like a mouse. 3.5 millimeter headphone jack there at the back. And at the front here, that is our USB 4 port. So this is display port out. It can act as Thunderbolt 3 too as well. So that's going to support that. You could run an external GPU through this. And then another two USB 3.2s. Our power button, and this is the exit vent, sorry, the intake vent on this side, exit vent is on the other, so that is where all the hot air is going to be blown out of the mini PC once it's under full load. And I'll report on the fan noise and the thermals, of course, in this review. The top of this mini PC has this plastic on it, so they will have the wireless antennas, they'll be underneath here, so the plastic is going to aid the reception, of course, of that, and there's just this little protection cover over the top of it. Just get rid of that. And then they have the AMD brand, well, logo there on the top, and MOREFINE or MOREFINE. I don't know how they want us to pronounce that. And along the bottom here, you'll see that's our intake there for the fan. And we do have four rubber feet, but I'm going to take a look at the internals now. Now, removing the underside of it, we can gain access then to one of the PCIe 4.0 SSD slots. So 22 by 80 is the size of it. And something like the Samsung 980 Pro would be perfect in there too. So there are two screws on the back. Once you remove those, you can then pry open this top cover, remove that, but be very careful of the antennas. So you can see the antennas are located here on that lid where we do have that plastic top. There is metal here. That is where the 2.5 inch drive will go. You've got the SATA 3 connector right there, then the power connector. We have our two RAM slots here, and they are DDR5 specs. So they are 4.8 gigahertz, the speed of these, and I've got 32 gigabytes installed. You could upgrade to 64 or maybe even higher if you wanted to do so. And we've got our SSD here. So this one, I believe, is only a PCIe 3 spec SSD, according to the speeds I'm seeing from it, which I'll show you in the review. later on. And we've got a replaceable card here. So that's a MediaTek card. It's Wi-Fi 6E. You could swap that out for something else if you wanted to do so. So it's easy enough to swap out, upgrade the RAM, change and swap the wireless card, and add an additional two SSDs if you wanted to do so. So that's great to see. Now, I do have some really good news when it comes to the BIOS. If you're someone that likes to tweak your mini PCs, it's completely unlocked to us. So this is excellent. If you go into the Advanced tab, you can see we've got everything. All the settings are here. You have AMD CBS. So under MBIO Common Options, if you go to GFX Configuration, which is the 680M, you can then go along here and change the configuration to game optimized. Now, if you do this, it will be dedicating the maximum amount of RAM according to what RAM you have installed. So I've got 32 gigabytes of DDR5 RAM, and I believe with this configuration, it will dedicate then 4 to the graphics. So if you intend to game a lot, this is probably something you do want to do. But I will leave it here just on auto. Of course, it will share the RAM. It's shareable RAM anyway, because it's part of the system RAM. This is an APU setup, so it will scale that up automatically. But it has been proven dedicating some of that RAM will improve the lower average FPS. And there's all sorts of other settings in there. I won't go into those. One of them here actually is an interesting one, the system configuration. So this is where we can change the power limit. So by default, it's auto, which I believe will be the 45 watts TDP. So this is our power limit. But you could set this to 54. Now, 54 will give us a boost in performance, a little. The problem is it will increase the thermals and it will probably increase the fan noise. So I will just leave that as auto, default that one there. And maybe later I will actually change that. And if I do, of course, have thermal headroom. So plenty of options to change in there, but just be really careful. Those two I just showed you are the only ones I recommend you do touch. And of course, you've got boot order. Everything else is in here, which is good. So let's go over into Windows now. The version of Windows that it does run is Windows 11 Pro, and you will find that our free available RAM, we don't get the full 32 gigabytes because, of course, a little is dedicated to the 680M graphics. Now, if you look in the device manager, you will see that this APU, the Ryzen 9 6900HX, is listed here 16 times. Well, it's got 8 cores and 16 threads. Maximum turbo is 4.9 gigahertz, and it is a step up, yes, of course, over the previous generation. But on the CPU side, depends on what benchmarks you're running, it's not a huge amount, as you'll see. But we do have, of course, the dual gigabit, 2.5 gigabit LAN ports on there, which is great. You don't often see this option. And then the MediaTek Wi-Fi 6E. So that is the fastest at the moment. Of course, Wi-Fi 7 is coming, but this is the fastest really that most people will be able to run at the time of this video here. So that's good to see. And the SSD, it is not a PCIe 4 spec one, but the slot does support it because now it's all running PCIe 4, DDR5. They are some of those changes, and the USB 4 too that we do get with this revision, the newer architecture and everything. So the SSD, I've benchmarked that, and you can see the speeds, disappointing, especially those write speeds. I mean, if this was a PCIe 4 SSD, spec one, 4.0, then you'll be looking at 7,000 sequential reads and writes if it's a very good model, like, say, a Samsung. You've got a 980 Pro or something in there. So, of course, you can swap that out. You can upgrade, put in a faster drive. If these kind of speeds were an issue to you, you wanted a little bit quicker, you've got that option to add another one, as I showed you. So another PCIe 4.0 drive to expand upon your storage, and even a 2.5 inch drive. So what about the benchmarks? This is where things get a bit interesting, because CPU side of things with Cinebench, I am seeing similar scores here from the previous gen, from the 5900HX. So you can see single core score. Okay, that's up approximately maybe 50 to 80 points, a little bit there, and about 800 points more only or so that I'm seeing with our multi-core score here. So that's looping that benchmark there for 10 minutes, and it didn't throttle. No thermal throttling, but I'll just show you the thermals now. You can see it got up to 90.1 degrees Celsius. Ambient temperatures here at the moment are about 20. So it's good. I mean, no throttling, that is fine. But where you do see a boost in the performance is this right here. So Geekbench 5. Okay, finally. Now we're seeing quite a bit of a change here. So this multi-core score, that is up around about 11% over the previous generation. So the last mini PC I reviewed with the 5900HX, which was this here, the HX90G, you can see got almost 9,000 points, and now we're up just over the 10,000 point mark here for multi-core score. For a mini PC, a small PC like this with a mobile chip, that's a fantastic score, really good. Single core performance, you can see it's gone up, well, about 90 points or so. It hasn't gone up a lot. So it's a minor increase there. It is the GPU side of things where we do get the performance benefits, of course. As for video playback, well, I'm going to go into YouTube here and I'll just bring up my test file. So this is streaming 4K. I'll enable those stats, but actually I'll just do that after I go full screen. Now you see here that it shouldn't really drop any frames at all. So everything I've thrown at it video-wise, so HEVC, 10-bit, 140 megabits per second, not a problem, okay? It will decode it, handle it just fine. The 680M integrated graphics, not an issue. And VP9 right now in Chrome with no problems. As long as you've got a good, stable internet connection, good fiber connection, then it will be able to do this just fine. So really good video playback performance, as we've seen with the previous generation. Testing out file transfer speed. So this is using the USB 4 Type-C port to an external NVMe drive. It's getting around about here. You can see real world sequential transfers of about 800, a little bit more than that. And that's probably actually being slowed down a little bit by the SSD within this. I think I can get a little bit higher than this. So excellent transfer speeds for large files. And if you wanted to do some video editing, I have right here Adobe Premiere Pro. It's the latest version, 2023, the latest updates and everything. Timeline I have set to a quarter playback resolution. Now these original files are 100 megabit. They are Sony 4K 30 files. And whoa, okay, that was a bit interesting. Bit of a glitch there. I don't know why that happened with the preview. That could be down to Adobe's software right here. But the timeline is looking very good, very fast when I skip ahead. And I'm not noticing too many drop frames or anything like that. Now the performance, you could probably even stick that to half resolution there, is looking good. So I'm just gonna hit play on this again. And that seems to be fine. I'm not detecting really any drop frames even at this half playback resolution. So this is only a simple 4K edit. It's only about 10 minutes, but I wanted to test out those export times too. So decoding, encoding should I say, and we'll see how it handles that at the YouTube default preset here in Adobe, 1 minute of footage only. And it is about to finish up. So once that bar disappears, there it goes. So you could say approximately 31 seconds. That's quick for 1 minute of footage. So excellent. So for basic 4K editing, I think this Speccer Mini PC, especially with the 32 gigabytes of DDR5 RAM here, is gonna be great for that. And finally, onto the graphics. I've been really excited to take a look at the performance kind of gains that we're gonna get. And normally out here with GTA 5, I've got it set 1080p, normal settings, and everything else in the middle when it comes to the pedestrian density and view distance. So I normally see around about 60 to 70 frames per second right here with the Vega graphics with the previous generation. And we're looking at a frame rate that is almost double, almost. I mean, sometimes it is double because I was getting about 60. That is really good. You can see out here over 100 frames per second now. So that's a huge step up in performance. It's looking at least like, well, you're not quite double, but I would have to say at least around 70% performance boost here. In the car, it has dropped down a little bit because, of course, it has to render all the interior of this car. So that's kind of normal. Driving around here, it's dropped down a bit. But not bad at all for GTA 5 running at 1080p. So if you are someone that wanted to use this, of course, for a little bit of light gaming, then this is, I would say, the model to go for, the models to go for. Wait for this newer 6000 series. If you can't get it yet in another type of mini PC or in a laptop or something, it's well worth the wait over the older graphics. And you can see looking at the clock there, it is throttling down a little bit. So that GPU is not holding, sadly not holding there the 2400 megahertz the whole time. So it is, there it is, it's at 2400, then it drops and throttles all the way down to 1500 megahertz. And the power limit seems to be the culprit here. It's 54 watts at the moment. Thermals don't seem to be too bad. So I don't know really why it is throttling like that. I think it's definitely the power limit. What about Cyberpunk? This is 2077 and we're looking at almost again double the frame rate here for 1080p. This is very good. I'm impressed. I mean, look at how many NPCs I do have. This is on the low preset setting, 1080p. Look at all those cars. And yes, there's screen tearing going on because I don't have VSync on. A lot of tearing, yeah, but that's just to do with the settings. But all this being rendered and still being able to get, look at that, 40 frames per second, 1080p on integrated graphics with such a demanding game. Wow, that is impressive. I am surprised by this performance. So that is a huge step up. We're talking not quite double the performance, but something close of what we have over, say, the Vega 8 graphics that you would have on the previous generation of this particular chip. The, of course, Ryzen 9, the 5900HX. And even walking around here, oh, that's so good. All that being rendered. I'm just going to quickly test out 720p now. Now, if you don't mind taking that hit on the resolution, 720p is the way to go on the low preset because look at this, almost 60 frames per second. Despite having the latest chipset, it does run Linux. So I have booted up here a live USB pen drive image of Linux Manjaro. Now, I go with Linux Manjaro and the open source drivers because it just seems to be the most compatible with all the tech I review. So Wi-Fi seems to work, Bluetooth's working, everything seems to be just fine here, which is good for those of you that want to run Linux on a mini PC like this. As I pointed out before, the thermals are very good with this particular mini PC, so it doesn't go over 90 degrees Celsius. And from the wall, it will pull around about 78, 77 watts, I'm seeing maximum. Idle is about 12 watts, but I do have an external hard drive plugged in, keyboard and a mouse, so that's making it a little bit higher there. And the fan is very good. You hear it sometimes under full load, but it's not that loud. And here is a sample of it playing Cyberpunk 2077, so pretty much under full load. So if you are in the market now, I feel, for a mini PC and you intend to game a little bit of light gaming at, say, 1080p, and you will be playing some more demanding titles, definitely don't look at the previous generation. So don't look at even the Iris graphics ones. Don't look at them, the Intels, the 12th gen or 11th gen, or the 5000 series. You really want to get the 6000 series now, from what I'm seeing with the graphics performance increase there, from going from, say, 70 frames per second at 1080p, and GTA 5 to now 120, 130 is a big step up. Now we've got plenty of options when it comes to ports. So you've got USB 4, three displays out. You can add an additional two SSDs in this, which is fantastic. Good fan noise, overall nice compact, small size. You can see it fits almost in the palm of my hand right here. There's only really two things for me, and that is the included SSD from MOREFINE, is a little slow. It's not PCIe 4, even though it supports it. The other is there's some graphics throttling that is happening. So instead of holding the 2.4 gigahertz the entirety of the time you're gaming, like we see with, say, the Vega 8 graphics previous gen, holding 2.1 gigahertz, it's throttling right down. And I saw with GTA 5 a little bit of throttling, but with Cyberpunk, it dropped down as low as 1.5 gigahertz for a few seconds, and then back up to, say, 2,100 megahertz. So there is clearly some throttling going on. I believe it's connected to the power limit. So I'll probably test out the 54-watt setting in the BIOS and maybe UMA game optimized to see if it will let us get past that throttling issue. And I'll probably have a follow-up video on that, or I'll let you know and pin a comment in this video if it does correct the issue. So thanks a lot for watching my review here on the MOREFINE M600.